In this video, I'm going to demonstrate the PC Raster Map Algebra tutorial. The tutorial is in Jupyter Notebook, but in this demonstration, I'm going to show you how to run the commands in a setup where you have the Anaconda distribution on your computer and you use Spider, and you can use the tools from PC Raster from the command prompt. So first we're going to activate the environment, Conda activate tutorials. Now we are in the correct environment. I go to the folder where the tutorials are. Go to the map algebra folder. There we find the Jupyter notebooks and we see the data folder. So I'm gonna run Spider, but I still want to use this command prompt. So I do start / b spider. And then it will start Spider and I can still use the command prompt. So we have these different TIFF files and we need to convert it to the PC Raster format to proceed with this tutorial. So we need to do some preparations. And we're going to use GDAL. Previously you have used GDAL from the command prompt and now you're going to see the equivalent in Python. So I'm going to use this IPython prompt here in Spider and import the library. We need GDAL and we need GDAL const. Then I'm going to open the TIFF file and I can set here the working folder. So I'm going to change that so I don't have to change that all the time, or so I don't have to explicitly mention it every time. So we are going to import the first TIFF file, the build.g.tiff. And we call the variable src underscore ds equals gdal open. That's where we start with to open a data set. You can use single or double quotes to define the string of the file name. build.g.tiff. And do enter. And now the TIFF file is opened with gdal. And then we can translate it to the PC Raster map file. On the command prompt, we would use gdal translate, and remember that then we had to specify the output format and the value scale of PC Raster. Here I'll show the equivalent in Python. We define the output variable equals gdal.translate. That's the same as gdal translate, but a little different syntax. First, we define the output data set name. That is buildg.map. Then the source data set, that is srcds that we have just opened, the geotiff. Then we can give several options, and what we need to give is the format. So that will be the same as minus of on the command line. And the format is PC Raster, the output format. And we need to give the output data type. I need a comma here. Output type. And that would be gdal const dot. And then you give gdt underscore int 32. So that's the way of specifying the integer 32 output type, which is needed because this is a nominal map. And what we need to also specify in the PC Raster data type. And we do that with the metadata options. And there we use value scale nominal. So the output will be a PC Raster nominal map. We close the bracket. So that's done. The file has been converted, but not written to disk yet. Therefore, we need to flush the dataset to disk by closing these variables. And you do that simply by dst ds equals none. And then it will be written to disk and It's also nice to close the source dataset in the same way. There it is. Now let's check our disk. So I'm in the data folder, type dir, and I see there that we have now buildg.map, which is the PC raster format, and I can even visualize it using Agila. That's the PC raster tool for visualization. And there it is, it's nominal. We see the different classes, 5 classes, and this is the map. So that all works. So we can now write a script that can translate all the maps at once based on these lines of code that we have used. I'm going to paste it here. We missed the gdal const. I'm going to add that here. And then this function needs as an input the source file name, the destination file name, the output data type, and the value scale for PC raster. Then you recognize the commands that we've used. And here, let me put this on the next line by using backslash. So here we have the destination file name, the source, the format, the output type, and the metadata options, and we flush it. And then here we can convert it with the different formats. You can see it completely. And we don't need the first one because we already did that one. I'm going to hash it out. And then we can save the script. And I'll put it in map algebra. So all the code is then relative to the map algebra folder if we run it. And I'm going to call this one div2pcraster. And then I can run it. Now it has run, and let's check the result. And now we see all the maps are here. We can use Agila to view them all. Agila. So we had buildg.map, we had dtm.map, gwlevel.map, and roads.map. And now we can open them all. And here we see the elevation in the area, land use, buildings, groundwater level, and two different road types. We can close all the windows at once by doing file exit. So let's inspect the data before we proceed, because for map algebra, the properties of all raster layers used in calculations need to be the same. Let's find out if they have the same number of rows, columns, coordinates, and pixel size. Let's first open one of these PC raster files with gdal. Call it raster layer equals, and then we learned gdal open. And then note that we are back in map algebra, so I'm going to change it to map algebra data. So that's our working directory. Then I don't have to specify the folder, and I'm going to just open dtm.map that we just created. Now it's open. And to get the numbers of rows and columns, we can use different gdal functions, the raster x size and raster y size. And we can use raster layer.getDescription to get the relative path of the layer. So let's start with getting the path, raster layer.getDescription. Made a typo, raster layer. And then the number of columns is raster layer dot raster x size, and number of rows equals raster layer dot raster y size. And now let's print that. And you can use this formatting option. to substitute what's in brackets later with the variables. As that's much easier than substituting inside the string. And then we use format. And then the first one is the path. The second one is number of columns. And the third one, number of rows. We need to close with two brackets. And there we see it. And there it is. DTM.map has 60 columns and 60 rows. To know the coordinates and pixel size, we can use getGeoTransform from GDAL. It returns a tuple with the following information. Index 0 of the tuple gives the top left x coordinate. Index 1, the west-east pixel resolution. Index 2, rotation, 0 for north up. Index 3, top left y coordinate. Index 4, rotation, 0 for north up, and index 5, north-south pixel resolution, and then that should be negative. So let's use this, master layer dot get geo transform, and here we see the tuple with the information, and let's make that also more readable. So again, we do print, then we can say origin equals, and then we fill it in later with the correct values, which are master layer dot get geo transform, index 0 of the tuple, master layer get geo transform, position 3 of the tuple. Then we close the brackets. So now we have a readable origin coordinate. And we can do the same for the pixel size, print pixel size equals. And we'll substitute this later with format. And then raster layer dot get geo transform position 1 and master layer position 5 and two brackets to close it. Made a typo, needs a dot here. And here you see that the pixel size is 50. So the pixel size is in the x and the y direction, and the y direction has a negative 1. Because they are equal here, it means these are square pixels of 50 units. And the units depend on the projection. We can also use GDAL to get the projection information. The PC raster format doesn't store the projection information, but when we converted the rasters, it saved an XML file with the projection info in the well-known text format. The GDAL function to use for that is getProjection. Raster layer dot get projection, and this will print the well-known text format for this projection. That's not very readable, so we are going to parse this using another library, the PyCRS library that we already installed when we installed Anaconda. So I'm going to import this library, import PyCRS. And then I'm going to read those projection properties in a variable, raster layer projection equals raster layer dot get projection. So now the well-known text is stored in this variable, and then I can parse it. So the coordinate reference system equals PyCRS dot parse, and then we need to define the format from OGC WKT, so it knows that it uses the OGC well-known text format, and that is read from raster layer projection, which has the whole format. So that's done and stored in CRS. And now we can check if it is a projected coordinate system. So we can then use is instance CRS. That's the variable that we made, and then by CRS dot approach CS. And it says true, which means that it is a projected coordinate system. And we are not dealing with a geographical coordinate system. But it would be more helpful to have the name of the projection. So for that we can use projection name as a variable equals crs.name. And we print it, print projection name. And it says it is a WGS 84 and UTM zone 30 north. We can also get the units of the projection. So let's make a variable projection units equals CRS dot unit dot unit name dot OGC underscore WKT. So from the projection, use the unit, use the name of the unit, and it's in the well-known text. And then we can print it, print projection units, and it says meters. Finally, it would be useful to get some statistics from the raster layer. Let's calculate the minimum and maximum value. Because raster layers can have multiple bands, we need to select the band. In our case, we have a single band raster layer, so we have to choose band 1. It starts numbering from 1, not from 0. So let's first select the band, raster layer band equals raster layer dot get raster band. And then, as we said, we have one layer, one band, so it's always 1. And then we can calculate the minimum and maximum value of the band using get minimum and get maximum. So raster layer minimum equals raster layer band dot get minimum. And for the maximum, let me just change it a bit. And let's print them. Minimum raster layer minimum 201. That's the minimum value. And let's do the same for maximum raster layer maximum 298. So that's all very useful, but if we want to compare multiple rasters, it's better to write this in a script. I'm gonna make a new script, and this is the script that we need for that, which contains all these code that we've already tested on 1, and it just needs the raster layer from GDAL that we have opened. So in the main script here you see the DTM layer, we open it, and then we call the function with the DTM layer, and it will run all these lines to get the information and print them in a proper way. So let's save this one, and let's call this metadata.py, and let's run it. There it is, and it prints here in the console the results. So DTM 60x60, that one is for one band, these are rows and columns. The projection, units, the origin, the pixel size, and the minimum and maximum value. So we've made a script that can easily read metadata from the file. And we can conclude here that all the projections and spatial properties are the same, and that this is suitable for doing map algebra. So we can continue. So the first condition to find the inaccessible wells is that the wells need to be within 150 meters from houses or roads. So we need to create a Boolean layer with true for houses and false for other buildings. And we need to create zones of 150 meters around the houses. And then we repeat the same for the roads. So let's start with creating a Boolean layer with true for houses and false for other buildings. And we're going to import PC Raster now. So from PC Raster, import star. PC Raster is imported now. And our data is stored in the data folder, so I need to change it back here. When we have run this script, it changed back to where the script was run, so always keep an eye on where you are. And then we can read with PC Raster the map file that we created in the previous steps to a variable, so buildings equals, and we use the read map operator. And here we read buildg.map from the disk, and it's stored in the variable buildings. And we can easily visualize this with Aguila that comes with PC Raster. So in the notebook that is not possible because it is a separate program, but here it is possible. So we can run Aguila from the command prompt. There is an Aguila Python operator here, which will give a pop-up with the map. But if we have multiple maps, that's not so useful because it gives a temporary file. So therefore it is recommended to not use this Aguila from Python, only if you want to quickly check the result, but use it from the command prompt. So I can do here Aguila buildg.map, and that refers then to the file. But if it's for the variables in the script, we use Aguila and then the name of the variable, and it will give a pop-up. So that doesn't work in the Jupyter notebook. So let's have a look at it again. And we see it has five classes. Class 0 is none. Class 1 is house. Class 2 is public building. Class 3 is landfill. Class 4 is industry, and class 5 is mine. That's given in the tutorial. And we first need to create a Boolean layer with true for houses and false for other buildings. With map algebra, that is really easy. We can say houses equals buildings equals exactly 1. So 1 equal sign means add it to the variable, and two equal signs means it needs to be exactly equal. So they have a different meaning. So we have now created the houses variable, which is a map and which we can visualize. So let's do that. And there it is. So in green, true, we have all the houses, and in red, false, we have all the other classes. That's good. That's what we need to proceed with. And then we want to create zones of 150 meters around the houses, and therefore we use the PC Raster spread max zone function. So remember, you can find all the PC Raster functions on the PC Raster documentation website. So let's apply this. Houses 150 meter equals, and then the name of the operator, spread max zone, and then the input is the Boolean map with the houses. Then we have to define an initial friction, which is 0. There's no initial friction, but each cell that it crosses has a dimension of 1 friction, which is the distance. And then the maximum distance is 150 meters. Close the bracket. I can run it. You see that's quite quick, so I can visualize it. Houses 150. And this is the result, a buffer around the houses of 150 meters. So we can do the same around the roads. So let's have a look at the roads map. Let's first read the roads map. And then have a look at it. There it is, and there are two types of roads. And we want to have the distance to any type of road. So one and two are valid. So I'm going to make a new layer. Is road equals roads, and road should not be zero. So if it's zero, it is false. And if it's one and two, it's true. That works. I can check it, if we can now see all the roads. There it is, we have all the roads. And now I need the maximum distance of 150 meters. So with the arrow up, I can get back the one that we used for houses. And we replace it with roads 150 m. And here we use is road. Press enter, and then we can visualize it. And there we see the 150 meter buffer around the roads. Now we can save these files to a disk using report. So report, and then the name of the variable, so houses 150 meter. And we save it as houses 150 meter dot map. And we do the same for roads. There it is, and we can then check it. And there, houses 150 meter and roads 150 meter are added, so we can with Aguila visualize them. And there they are. The second condition is that we don't want industry, mine, or landfill within 300 meters from the wells. For the second condition, we first need to reclassify the buildings layer in such a way that the result is a Boolean map with true for industry, mine and landfill, and false for the other classes. Then we need to calculate the distance to the true pixels, and finally calculate the pixels that are further than 300 meters from industry, mine and landfill. So let's create a Boolean raster with true for industry, mine and landfill, and false for other buildings. For that purpose, we can use so-called lookup tables. And we use the lookup operator. And it depends on the output data type how we write that operator. So if it's a Boolean, we use lookup Boolean. If it's nominal, lookup nominal, etc. And we need a table, the lookup table. Let's have a look at a lookup table. So the table that we are going to use here is industry.tbl. And here we see it. And it has on the first column the values of the raster. And in the second column, the recoded values. And here we see that classes 0, 1, and 2 will be 0, so Boolean false, and 3, 4, and 5 will be Boolean 1. So let's use that. So we can say industry equals lookup, because the output is Boolean, it will be lookup Boolean. And then we use the table. industry.tbl and the buildings layer, that we have previously imported. There it is, so let's visualize the result. So there it is, in green are all the industry areas and in red are all the other areas. So now we need to create zones of 300 meters around industry, mine and landfill, so around these green pixels. And previously we used the spread max zone operation, but there doesn't exist a spread min zone to get the minimum distance. So there are different ways to solve this, and I'm going to show that. So the first method is the fastest method, I think, is we can use a spread max zone and then invert the result by using the not operator. So industry max 300 meter, that's our output variable, spread max zone. And as an input, we use our Boolean industry map, initial friction 0, then one cell for each that we cross, and then a maximum of 300. There it is. And then if we want the minimum, we can say industry min 300 meter is the opposite, is not. And there we use this symbol, industry max 300 meter. So not, the tilde inverts true and false. Let's have a look at both maps. And there they are, indeed each other's inverse. We can also do it in a different way. We can calculate all the distances to industry. And let's call that industry distance equals, and there we use the spread function from PC Raster. And the input is the Boolean industry map, initial friction 0, and then 1 for each cell that it crosses. There it is. Let's have a look. So here for each cell we have the distance in meters to an industry pixel. Note that you can change the scale by clicking right and then edit drop properties, and you can choose another palette. Closer to industry would be bad, so let's make it red to green. Now, with this result, we can create a Boolean condition, industry min 300. Let's make it version 2, so we can later compare if they are exactly the same. Industry distance, that's the distance map, larger or equal 300. So this means if industry distance has pixels which are larger or equal to 300 meters, then it's true, else it's false. Well, you can visualize the result. And there we see that it looks the same. And in the third method, we can use a lookup table. And in lookup tables, we can also use ranges. So I'm going to show you that file. This is the file. And this means that any value less than 300 has 0. And values larger than or equal to 300 get Boolean true. So let's use this, industry min 300, 3 equals lookup boolean, and the first argument is the table, the map, which is industry distance. Let's look at this one too. And it looks also the same. Now, to be sure, we can plot all of them. And we see that they are all exactly the same. So let's save this to the disk. We can just choose one of them. Report industry min 300M. And I'm going to save it as int 300M.map. And now it's on our disk. For the last condition, we need to identify the wells that are less than 40 meters deep. The file groundwaterlevel.map gives the absolute elevation of the groundwater level in the well in meters above sea level. In order to calculate the depth to the groundwater, we need to subtract this from the surface elevation given in the digital terrain model, dtm.map. So let's read the two files. And with map algebra, it's very easy to subtract them. So the well depth equals the surface level from the DTM minus the absolute groundwater level. Let's look at the result. There we see it. It's a continuous scalar map, which gives the distances to the water, the depth. Now we can calculate a Boolean raster where pixels with a depth less than 40 meters are true and larger equal to 40 meters are false. So let's call it not deep equals well depth less than 40. So that will give true for the wells that are less than 40 meters and false for larger or equal to 40 meters. Let's look at the result. And there it is. So let's save this to the disk. Report not deep, not deep dot map. So we have calculated different Boolean maps for all these criteria. So let's combine them. And the result should be a Boolean map where the accessible wells are located at the cells where all the conditions are true. Therefore, we need to use the AND operator. So we can write the equation here, accessible wells equals, and then all the different Boolean maps with the ampersand symbol, which means AND for PC raster. And then we can visualize the results. With only these three wells being true, so accessible, and the other ones being not accessible. So what's the advantage of scripting map algebra? Because the same procedure can also be done in QGIS, as you can see in another tutorial. So what's the advantage of using this instead of a graphical user interface? Well, first you have more control over the functions because you determine each argument and operator that you use. The process becomes reproducible. Anyone else can run the script with the input data to obtain exactly the same results. The code is transparent, it's open source. And you can easily modify the criteria and see how it affects the result. For that last purpose, we're going to put all this code together into one script. And we make it also clearer by writing certain processes as functions. And then we can play around with these different criteria and see what works best. So there's a bit of a scenario analysis. I'm going to make a new file. Let's run it. And you see it's fast. This is the result, but we can now play around with the results. We can say, what if we increase the first condition to 250 meters? Save it and run it. And we see that there are two more accessible wells here in the north. So with this script, we can play around with these different conditions and see the effect of that, which is very useful for planning.